Arts Council and Beverly Hills Arts Commission, is the former West Coast editor of Andy Warhol's Interview magazine and society editor of the Herald Examiner. Her cover stories can be read in Venice and Detour magazines, and she is a contributing editor to California Apparel News. For the next half hour, Joan will bring you inside news and views on society, art, film, and the exhilarating worlds of these multifaceted people. Here is Joan Quinn.
Welcome to Joan Quinn, Etc. We have a great show for you today. Our guests are actress Susan Tyrrell and actor Ricky Dean Logan. Susan Tyrrell will look familiar to you from John Waters' Cry Baby, Andy Warhol's Bad, and Big Top Pee Wee. In a way, all underground films. But she didn't start underground. She knew about the business. Her father was a William Morris agent who believed enough in his daughter's acting ability to get her work in summer stock. She worked with Art Carney. She proved to be a natural. A few years later, in 1972, she was nominated for an Academy Award for her performance in John Huston's Fat City. She was just 18 years old. Susu has written what she calls a bitter operetta, My Rotten Life. The one-act play is all Tyrrell from beginning to end. It's been sold out at the Pink in Santa Monica, the Cinegrill in Hollywood, and the Cage in Los Angeles. Her producer plans to keep her moving throughout the state and also throughout the country, telling about her personal tales. Susan, let's start at the beginning. Where did your career start?
I haven't gone back there in so long.
To your career?
I try to stay as far away from it as possible.
I see.
I don't know, Connecticut somewhere, high school production. But it went very fast from that high school production. There was an agent there, Bim Bam Boom. I went to New York. My dad died right then, and I kind of did it to show him, or did it for him.
The stage work?
Yeah, I never liked it. I never liked acting. I do it to get the money to go and travel and go live 2 years in Spain, in Colombia. I've just been in Tibet. I leave, and when I can't run out of bleach, I have to come back to Hollywood.
And do something to pay for your bleach.
Yeah.
When you were nominated, you were for an Academy Award, you were so young, and we're all young one time, but anyway, do you attribute that to John Huston's direction? Did he pull something out of you that wasn't there or that you didn't know existed?
You're asking, this is a touchy subject, you know.
No, I don't know. I hear it's a touchy subject, but I don't know about it.
Well, it's in the show a little bit, but the director who has the affair with the poodle.
Yes.
Because he treated me like a dog. No, he gave, you know, it was in spite of him. I was acting in spite of him. It was another thing I'll show you.
Was it difficult?
Yes, it was very hard. He's famous for being a real prick to women. It's in all the books. It's nothing new. It's just it was new to me, and I loved him very much. He was a grandfather to me.
So you did try to bring yourself to the position of really giving everything you had because of the respect you had for him, or because you
I had
were
no respect for him. I just said don't, you know, don't. It's survival. It was absolute survival, and I knew I just took a hold of it, and I, you know, for my very life, I acted for my life to keep him away from me and just to be the best I could. Against all odds.
And so that
And I remember Ray Starr came to me at one of the screenings that we'd all look at the film after the dailies. He said, you're going to be nominated, you know. And I said, I know.
You knew it? You
yeah,
felt
I knew.
It?
We all knew. It was the strongest thing in there.
But see, I didn't. And then what happened to you after the movie?
I went to Morocco for 2 years.
And just disappeared?
After every picture I made, I disappear. So I really do not. I don't like a group work. I'm not a group type person.
I see.
But I'm very lazy. I have a long career of shame, the stuff I'm incredibly ashamed of. It came from because I just went for the buck. You know, the first thing that was available, never thinking to plan a career.
I didn't realize the John Huston story. I thought maybe you had had an affair with him and that you'd run away with
him.
This
is the first time I've ever spoken about it.
Well, that's why I didn't know.
Let's put it this way. Don't ever call it an affair.
Okay, well, that's what I wanted to know.
In my show, she says, he was a grandfather to me, but in Hollywood, grandfathers rape you. We all know this now.
Yeah, so that's what led me to think maybe I've missed
the
whole point.
Closer to that. Right.
No, I missed the point. Maybe you were having something with him and he was so old and you were so young.
Right.
But I think you've explained it. And I think we're on
the
edge.
No, it's just the beginning. When my book comes out, I'll go into graphic detail.
That's what I was wondering, what's coming up next. But just before we get into your bitter operetta and your life story, let's talk about the kind of bizarre people you've worked with. We talked about being an underground actress, which I don't think you are, but that's what people think of Susan Tyrrell. And you worked with John Waters, who is definitely an underground.
In his first above ground piece.
Yes, and how did it work?
I didn't think it worked. I like his other things, but I like his raunchier things better. I'm happier in his underground, believe me.
Uh-huh.
I just like above ground box.
Yeah,
I like to make a lot of money doing, you know, really great stuff of merit that tends to be, you know, funny and way out there, and that is underground.
What about Andy? Did you get a chance to work with him, or was it Paul Morrissey who turned on the camera?
It was Andy coming in saying, "Could we have some shots of products?"
Oh, that's right.
He always wanted products
to make his big bucks. That's what he was always thinking about money.
Truman Capote called him the Sphinx without a secret.
Right.
Which I love that.
Because you could never get to him anyway.
Mr. Vapid.
Exactly. That's what you said.
I always used to try and hug him because he couldn't stand to be touched.
Oh, I know. Ah! It just used to repel him, didn't it?
He's fun to torture.
He probably loved you, though, with your ice blonde hair.
I didn't have blonde hair then.
What were you?
Brown.
Oh, you haven't always
brown
been a blonde.
Mouse. No, I was very heavy. Remember Bad? Did you ever see Andy Warhol's
Bad? Yes, but
I miserable. Everybody was beautiful and bad, and I was good and ugly.
I got it. What about Pee Wee Herman?
What about him?
I don't know. Did you play in that movie?
I love Paul.
Who is?
Paul Rubens,
who plays Pee Wee.
Very dear friend of mine. I love him very much. No, that movie was, well, see, the movie was shot, and I came in afterwards, worked blue screen. So I'm alone, so I like that.
Oh, so you like
that.
I
love acting alone.
Well, acting alone really takes us to your to what you're doing on stage. Mm-hmm. You're doing a one-woman show. But you can't mount that alone. You've got so many people working for you.
I have an extraordinary crew, Wendy and Carol, those Phillips girls.
Yes.
Who do light, sound, and it is a musical. So I had an extraordinary composer, two composers, Fred Myro and Michael Andreas. And then the incredible Rocky Schenk.
So what do? They run a tape, and they have a percussionist.
I have live percussion, which is lots of sound effects.
Fabulous.
Right.
That worked
makes
out.
It come alive.
Yes.
With Darrell Harris.
And we're going to see, and Darrell said, remember how to spell my name
I'm
right.
I'm sure he did. Well, here's his big chance.
We're going to see a clip of that, and we'll see a little bit of the show, and then we'll go back and talk to you.
Great.
So we'll see My Rotten Life.
This is wow. Zap on your neck. Do you ball? Black bull. The smells of the rain.
Susan, that was really wonderful, and I think everyone has to go and see that two or three times, because you never get what's going on the first time.
They do. They
come many times. How much of it is really true to life?
It's a cartoon. It's a surreal cartoon of some terrible things that I witnessed.
So it's expanded.
I just wanted to string these pearls of tragedy comedy. Every tragic moment is a setup for hilarious joke.
I see.
So it's very funny, and it could be campy, but I think the real place that it comes from is the loserness of it, of her suffering and her longing to be alive again.
I read in some of the things that interviews that you've given that you said it was a catharsis, it was a cleansing of your soul.
Yes.
And do you, when you look at it, do you still feel that playing it over and over?
No. Now it's just the sheer skill of acting it, because it's exhausting. But the writing of it, I was seriously in trouble. I was at the end of, you know, the career and everything. So it came, poured out of.
So that was the best time for you to write.
Yeah.
When I was at one of the performances, you were in a very kind of racy little dress, and one of the young girls across the room said, "Oh, look at Susan. She is so sexy. Look at those teardrops that she has tattooed on her back." Do you feel comfortable in that persona?
Yeah, well, they're behind me, so I don't have to look at them.
But being a sex symbol of sorts?
It's fine with me. I'll take anything, you know, like that. But at the time, I thought they were appropriate. You know, now they seem a little too subtle for me.
Oh, right. bigger and better things. Well, now that you've killed yourself off in this bitter operetta, My Rotten Life, what's next?
I'm going to live, baby. I want to live so I can afford jewelry like yours, darling.
So that's where we're going next. We'll see you at the jewelry shop.
In La Cage Folle.
In La Cage, right. So look for Susan Tyrrell in My Rotten Life.
Sundays and Mondays.
Yes. And look for her in New York. Look for her in San Francisco. Look for her all over. And Susan, thanks for being with us.
You're so sweet. Thank you for asking me.
When we come back, we'll have Ricky Dean Logan, a young actor. Did you hear all the noise? There were women outside screaming for Ricky Dean Logan. All his fans. Anyway, Susan had to run off. She saw all those screaming women, and she decided to leave. Ricky Dean Logan was born and raised in Oakland, California. He never, ever dreamed of being an actor. What actually got him away from his large family was his love of music. When I first met Ricky Dean at Darren Ramirez's house, he was coaxed into singing. Or should I say lip singing? Syncing. I think he was way ahead of that lip syncing thing. He really wasn't singing. He could have sung it, though. But in school, he was known as the class clown. And this performance really proved it. He tucked a bath towel into his jeans. He wrapped his head with a dish towel. And he grabbed a broom, which he used as a mic. And he sang Diana Ross. And everybody laughed. We were on the floor. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do. Well sort of. I remember the next morning anyway.
You were
I remember
great.
You telling me about it and seeing the shot that you did in the newspaper.
I was the society
newspaper ad, right.
I was the society editor at the Herald Examiner. And of course I was covering the party, and this was like,
it was amazing.
This was like the lead shot. So from singer to actor, how did
like
it happen?
Like that, just like that.
Right.
You wrote it first.
Did I make it?
Yeah, you did.
What's your real name?
Ricky Dean Logan.
That's your real name?
Yes,
what
that's
kind
my given name.
What kind of background are you?
I'm a Portuguese, Irish, Indian. I'm a mutt.
Yeah, well, it's easy basically for you to go up for all these different types of ethnic roles,
right,
or mean bad,
right,
boy roles.
Right, yeah, I go up for a lot of that. I go up for a lot of younger than I am roles. You know, I got that young face, they say. So, but yeah, I go up for mean guys. I'm trying to get out of that and go in for a little more of the nice, you know, Beverly Hills High School type kids. Yeah.
Think you'll ever make that?
Yeah, I think so. I'm working on it. You know, so I got my hair back nice today. And
but in a short, what is it, 6 years only?
It's been 5 years.
5 years?
Yeah, this year.
You've been in Freddy's Dead, The
right.
Final Nightmare,
right.
Back to the Future 2.
And 3. Right.
Tell us, and I'll go through the rest of the list. Solar Babies, Predator 2, Nightbreaker.
Right, that was
Guilty
with Martin Sheen.
Heat of Passion. Tell
Sally
us a
Kirkland.
Little bit about the characters as they line up in these roles that you play.
One of the first things I did was a film called Nightbreaker, which was with Martin Sheen, Emilio Estevez, Leah Thompson. I mean, a lot of good people were in it. And I played a soldier in 1956 when they were doing the testing. And Martin Sheen and all of us went up to Nevada and got arrested and stuff like
did?
That. Yeah, we went and did that stuff. Martin's really good with those kind of things. That's what he's fighting for, and he does those kind of films. And it was a really good film. And Joanna Ray cast that one too, a good friend, right? And I played a soldier. They cut my hair all off. It was really weird. I had really long hair, and you get really vain, you know, you got the blow dryers out and you got everything. And I went to the set in Nevada, and Emilio Estevez came in the trailer and said, butch it. And they took a little thing and they just, like Freddy Krueger cloth, and just took me down to this high. And I went up to my hotel room and I opened the suitcase, and the first thing that was staring at me was the blow dryer, and I just chucked it out the 10th floor window into the swimming pool, and it was all over for
that. Was the end.
So yeah, so I learned that you know, it was a good lesson, because sometimes when you have your hair like that, you don't realize how much you play with it and you fuss with it, and you know, so it was nice. It was
but
nice to have it.
Sometimes it makes a good character part,
sure,
to have it.
Sure.
You can do this.
I can
back,
do this. I pulled it back today, can... right? I have it in the clip you'll see earlier. I have it down and fun.
But did you take it? That was one of your first roles.
That was
roles.
One of my first roles.
Did
yeah.
you take acting lessons when you came to
nope,
Hollywood?
No, nope, nope. I've never had any. Never took any classes. Never went to any acting.
How do you know what to do?
I don't know. I think it's coming from my background in Oakland. I had a really big family, and just I was a class clown. I was always, you know, when you switch schools a lot, you have to go in and become friends right away with people. So mm-hmm. I learned to make people laugh, and it's just something I love to do. And even when I'm trying to be serious on camera, somebody will come, you know, I seen that show you did, you're so funny. And I'm like, I was really trying to be serious on that one.
But that's one part of
yeah.
it, being funny. But
right.
the other part is like really learning to
sure, being,
pull your emotions
pulling it together.
Out.
And that's exactly what I do. I before I get a character, I just read the character, find out what he's been through, and I pull something that we have in common together.
Do
me
you really?
And the character, and that's what I do. And I just, when they say action, I just do it. I don't like, you know, I don't run around the block if I have to come in breathing hard. I don't.
You're like self-taught?
Yeah, I don't do any of that stuff. Yeah, I just, they say action, and I just go into the character. If I'm crying or screaming or, you know, on the Freddy's Dead, the Freddy's Last Nightmare one, I had a lot of stuff I had to do on that film. He blows my head up. they go back to my mom when I was a kid. Who put a Q-tip in my ear and made me go deaf. I play a deaf kid.
So
and
you
I
have
just
a
pulled
lot.
Yeah, I just pulled from my experiences as a young kid, sure.
So your roles have just been building and building.
Building and building, yeah. Yeah, they certainly have.
And one of the last films released was Guilty as Charged.
Guilty as Charged, right, with Rod Steiger and Lauren Hutton, who's wonderful, and Zelda Rubinstein from Poltergeist.
I know Zelda
Heather
for
Graham,
some.
Heather Graham's in it. Lyman Ward is in it, who is wonderful.
So where
Isaac
was that
Hayes.
Shot? Where was it shot?
That was shot here, actually. That was shot here in L.A., all in a studio.
Can you make two films at the same time? I've never...
Can I shoot two films
uh-huh.
at the same time? Well, Michael, when I was working with Michael J. Fox on Back to the Future, when he first started the first Back to the Future, he was shooting Family Ties and leaving the set at like 3 in the afternoon and working from 3 till 2 in the morning on Back to the Future. So it's possible.
So
I mean, you just have
like
to have
writing,
the energy. Yeah, it's...
Writing two books.
Sure. It's like you remember Joan when you used to go out when we were younger and party all night and then go to school or get up and go to work? Yeah,
or
it's sort
that,
of like
to
that.
Go to work.
Sure.
So it just depends on how much...
Depends on how you're doing.
You can just switch your character
right.
roles back and forth.
Right, right. No, I don't have to stop. Like, you think I have to
yeah,
stop in between?
Right.
No.
Or
no.
Stay in one mode?
No,
no,
I'm not that. I don't know if they call that, I really don't know much about classes, so I don't know if they call that method acting or what that is, where
I
you have
this.
To, you know, where you have to sit there and okay, I'm a chair now. It's like, no,
really?
I'm not into that.
I don't know very much about classes. This
no.
is so great.
Yeah, I really, you know, you got me on that one.
We do have a clip from Guilty as Charged,
right.
So.
This is the first one didn't work out because there was too much cussing in it, so we took that one out. This is when Rod Steiger captures me and puts me into this prison that he has in his basement. He owns a meat company, and he takes capital punishment in his own hands. And this is a scene with Isaac Hayes and myself, and Rod Steiger comes in. And this is when I, you know, wake up, and I'm in this cell in this basement. It's kind of funny, actually.
All right, we'll say it
okay.
now.
Do this to me. Here you go, Ricky. I would have gotten you a full robe, but you ain't gonna be here that long.
Christ, Al, he's just a kid.
Yeah, I'm just a kid, man. He's not a kid. He's a killer. And like it says in the Bible, old enough to kill, old enough to die.
You fool of shit, it doesn't say that in the Bible.
Yeah, it doesn't say that in the Bible, man. It says it in my Bible.
Nice handwriting, Al.
All right, listen up, Gruber. Due to circumstances beyond my control, I am forced to hold an execution tonight.
No, Mr. Callum, por favor, don't kill me, I swear.
How did you get that? It's all that sweat on your face?
Yeah, I guess that is method. I was thinking Africa. No,
I'm kidding. It was tough.
It's not tough when you got lights beaming down on you and you're sitting there, you know. You start to sweat when you have to get the energy up and you know. I mean, I woke up in this prison where this crazy guy was, like, electrocuting people right in front of me, so it's not hard to...
You're, like, dragging
Yeah, I was just like, you know, you let me out of here, you know?
They didn't squirt any water on you to sweat?
No, I was actually sweating on that one myself.
Actually, working with Rod Steiger must have been a great experience.
I'm telling you, you know, a lot of people ask me about that, about classes and where do you learn things. And that's where I learned things. I learned things from working with people like Rod Steiger, Michael J. Fox. You know, I mean, I've been lucky enough to work with really good people, good directors, Robert Zemeckis. And,
he's great.
You know, Rachel Talalay, who did Nightmare on Elm Street.
But and very professional people.
Very professional. When you get thrown into that, you either play...
And if you're smart, you learn.
That's what I do. I never sit in my trailer. I'm normally on the set watching every move. Oh, yeah.
How about getting roles like this? How do you actually get these roles?
Good management. No. There's a plug for Michael Hewitson, my manager, yes.
Is that what happens?
What happens is you know, your agency sends out a picture. They get what they call the breakdown. I don't know if you're familiar with that. It tells you what's going on, what's being cast right now. And your agent sends the picture out. They call your manager. Your manager calls you. You go on an audition with, 20 million other people.
Talk about that for a minute. Do they all look the same as you when you go to an audition?
It all depends. A lot of them, you know, I mean, I'm sort of a smaller person, so I get to go against, like, big guys and other different things.
Oh, you
things.
Do.
But
they're all different.
They're all different sizes, different shapes, different actors. It's different.
Do you run into the same
a
actors
lot. Yes.
time and time? Like, who
yeah.
is your kind of person
let me see. I go out a lot with Alexis Arquette, who you know. We both read for Last Exit to Brooklyn together,
yeah.
And we went into this thing in drag, which was kind of fun. So we meet each other in a lot of different ways, but it's normally the same set of people because you get to a certain point on your readings where you go directly to the directors or the producers, and the same people in your category will go to these same things. And it all depends on, you know, in this business, I think it's being at the right place at the right time, and then it's your talent after that, because
I think timing has a lot
to
do with it, and you have to be talented, but the timing
right.
always has to be
right.
there. When you lose out to, say, the same person that you've seen or been with
over and over,
are you discouraged?
No, not really, because I know, I mean, this is a business, Joan, that I could be in till I'm 90 and still working.
So you're not rejected.
I did that for the first 3 years. You know, I think everybody goes through it. You get that rejection feeling. You know, you really get your hopes up. And now the thing is, you just don't. You go in, you do your job, and you have to let it go. If they call you, great. If you get the job, great. If you don't, I mean, I'd be a basket case.
So you're just thinking ahead.
I'd have like four or five different, people I'd have to go see and talk to if I had to let that stuff get to me. It'd be crazy.
What about stage work? Have you ever been interested in doing stage work?
I haven't. My wife is in stage a lot, and I haven't really. I mean, I'd like to. I think I'd like to, because I say that the direct response is just, you know, a lot of fun. I did music, and, you know, it's the same thing where you have the crowd right there responding to your music. So I'd like to do some stage.
Right.
I think that would be great. Michael Hewitson, again, my management, he's done a lot of stage, you know, from England, and he's...
What about the Hollywood scene? Are you part of the Hollywood scene?
I was. For the first year, yeah, I was definitely, I was hanging out with Mickey Rourke and everybody at the bars and everything, and I met my wife, and thank God, Tamara Logan, yeah. you know, she pulled me aside, and she just said, what are you doing? You know, you got so much more on the ball. You don't need to be hanging out with these people and doing the bar scene. I mean, I think if I would have kept doing it, it would end up really costing me. Because, I mean, you do. You stay up all night, and you get in. I wasn't into acting, so I didn't know. I thought sitting at somebody's table was the big thing. I mean, Mickey Rourke's still a friend, and he's very cool, but
yeah.
I just don't hang out at the bars, and he doesn't do that much either. So.
Well, we can't hang out on the set anymore.
No.
Time's finished. It's over.
Are we done? Is it over?
Thanks.
Joan, it's
Ricky
been a pleasure.
Dean
Thanks.
Logan.
Great.
Thank you.
Can you get me past these girls? Or
we'll
no?
get
I'm
you
kidding.
Past all the girls outside. Thanks for being with Joan Quinn, etc. We'll see you next time.